Here we go. Roll video.
I think anybody creating something new must have an adventure.
It's not cinema, it's something else.
My advice to a young filmmaker is to make a movie every week.
The whole bag of movies can be learned in about a day and a half.
But suspense is essentially an emotional process.
You gotta make films. You gotta make it and get a scene.
Cinema for me is a world of when I dream.
Welcome to Behind the Slate. I am your host, Aaron Strand. And oh, Jesus Christ, I can't believe that it's August already. I'm not going to come on here and issue another apology about not putting out more episodes. At this point, it feels rather disingenuous. I am actively working on plans to build and expand this show, but that's really all I'm going to say for right now. In the meantime, this past Tuesday, we did another live show at the beautiful Plaza Theatre here in Atlanta, Georgia, and we screened the film Five Easy Pieces. It was a little harder than usual to get this film. Richard Martin, who does all the booking for the Plaza Theater, he kind of had to go back and forth with Sony, who I believe is the distributor. At first, they said they had a 35 millimeter print that we could use, which I was super excited about because 35 millimeter screenings, despite being $5 more expensive, they sell better. This is, of course, due to a sense of scarcity that the physical medium brings to this industry, something that we are severely losing in the grand business plan of film. But anyway, they kind of toyed around with us saying that we could have the 35 millimeter print. Well, a week went by and they said, oh, well, I'm not so sure. And then another week went by and they said, oh, I'm not so sure. And then another week and you get the picture. Finally, we ended up getting a DCP, a digital cinema package of the film. But you know what? Regardless, even though it wasn't on 35, we didn't get that grainy texture. This movie hit so hard. This is one of my favorite movies, and I don't think I would have said that about 8 years ago, but this is a movie that every time I rewatch it, it is just so effortlessly rewatchable. The depth and dimensions to these characters is really extraordinary, and I would definitely place this script up there with Double Indemnity and Tender Mercies as, I think, some of the greatest scripts ever written. I watched this about 2 weeks before the screening, you know, in preparation as I was getting my facts together. And oh my God, I ugly cried in my little TV room. It was horrible. When we screened it at the Plaza, I cried again, but this one, like, I was able to like keep it together and just like let the tears flow and then wipe them away because I had to get back up on stage like 60 seconds later. Anyway, yeah, this film is amazing. It was also really cool because my wife was able to attend this screening because our daughter is spending a week with her grandmas. And it was funny. She doesn't get to come out to the shows very often because we're often splitting parent duty. And it was funny. She came out and every time Jack Nicholson's character did something, you know, because he's like a real piece of shit throughout this film. And every time he did something misogynistic, she just gave me this look like, really? This is the movie you picked. This is the movie you brought me to see. This is how I'm spending my precious, you know, child-free night is watching this guy. What was so cool was that by the time we got home, I asked, okay, so, you know, what did you really think? And she was just kind of blown away by the empathy with which writer Carol Eastman, you know, gave to all of the characters. You know, every character was shown to be deeply imperfect. And yet, those imperfections were on display with a real love. And I just thought that was an incredible testament to the film. Anyway, the whole event was an absolutely wonderful night. Huge shout out to all the folks at the Plaza that helped, you know, make these things possible. I think the audience had a wonderful time. It was great to see, you know, some real regulars start to come to these shows. You know, we do them every other month. And the fact that we're like starting to get regulars, like people that keep coming back, it means so much to me. It's amazing to see these films and these conversations begin to connect to an audience. So if you're one of those people, yo, shout out to you. I love you. And I hope to see you again soon when we do the next one. In the meantime, I hope you enjoy the show. And without further ado, here is Behind the Slate Presents Five Easy Pieces.
Hello, 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 everybody. Welcome to Behind the Slate Presents. Hi, I am your host, Aaron Strand. Thank you guys so much for coming out tonight. Yeah, give it up, give it up. Yeah, thank you for coming out, enjoying a movie on a beautiful Tuesday night. So if you've never heard of us before, I'm going to get going really fast. I'm going to start stumbling over my words. If you've never heard of us before, Behind the Slate is a film history podcast where I take a historical deep dive into the life and work of cinema's greatest directors. You can follow us wherever you get your podcasts. You can check out our full series on Charlie Chaplin and Melvin Van Peebles. We also have tons of interviews with filmmakers, scholars, journalists. It's a bunch of good stuff. And if you've never been to our live show here before, what I like to do is I try to do a little version of the podcast before the film. So I get up here and I give, you know, not much, like 2-3 hours of historical context about the movie. And so if you want to use the bathroom, you can go use it now. No, I don't give 2-3 hours. About 10 minutes of historical context about the movie that will hopefully make these older films come more alive for you, and that we can feel them in their historical context, because as we all know, art is not made in a vacuum. We watch the film, and then afterwards, I come back, and for those who can stick around, I open it up for a little audience discussion, hand the microphone around, and then all of this audio, right now, is being recorded for a podcast that will be released on the podcast feed next week. So pretty cool. And tonight's film, guys, I am really excited, because this is one of my favorite movies. Tonight's film, we get to enjoy 1970s Five Easy Pieces. And I'm going to start this off with a bit of a hot take. This is a spicy take. I don't know if you guys are ready for it. I need to check to make sure we got a fire extinguisher nearby for how hot this take is. I think this film, of all the new Hollywood films, I think that this is the most influential new Hollywood film ever made. I know. Your minds are blown. I can hear them blowing across the room. The reason I say that is because a lot of the new Hollywood movies were steeped in things that American films already did well. They were steeped. What do American films do well? Violence, loud sex, right? And a lot of new Hollywood films capitalized on these already very American themes, but it was this film that changed the volume. There is no violence. Well, there's a little bit of fighting, but it's not violence in a De Palma sense in this film. There's a little bit of sex, but it's like sad sex in this movie. It's not like sexy sex. You know what I mean? And this film really proved that movies in a bit more of a European art house tradition could financially succeed in the United States. So let's take a step back. New Hollywood, this term gets thrown around a lot. Probably many of you are familiar with it, but I want to just remember what the New Hollywood movement was. The New Hollywood movement was a period in film history beginning in the late 60s when the creative power shifted away from the studio bureaucracy where it had traditionally been held and was given to the authors of the film, usually a single person, and it was usually the director of the film. Now, this did not happen because studio executives like suddenly became like super cool with like good taste. No, this happened because in the mid-60s, the American film market was dying. Okay? The American film market in the mid-60s faced two major problems. The first was that a new technology had come along and disrupted box office receipts, and the second was that they kept producing the same big budget shit that no one gave a fuck about, okay? Sound familiar? Of course, now we have the internet, we have streaming, we have social media dominating the attention economy, and we have superhero movies. Back then, it was television, and it was westerns, and it was musicals. So, and I think this is really important context to remember, because we look at the names of the new Hollywood that we grew up with. Coppola, Scorsese, Spielberg, George Lucas, William Friedkin, Robert Altman, Mike Nichols, and we think of them as canon, but within their context, these people were incredible risks. They were Hail Marys from studio executives to try to keep this medium viable. Now, if you noticed in the names that I just gave, it's a big old sausage party, you know what I'm saying? Like, that is a whole bunch of dudes. Nothing against them, great artists, not taking anything away from them, but, you know, it's a big old dude fest, okay? And that's what really makes this film unique, because the main authorial voice of Five Easy Pieces came from a woman. It was screenwriter Carol Eastman. And this woman is pretty extraordinary and also pretty bizarre. I like to describe her as a Hollywood cryptid because she was seldom seen in the wild. For most of her life, she lived completely alone. She had no known lovers. In her 35-year career, she gave 2 published interviews, and otherwise, she completely eschewed public life. And so it's a little hard to talk about her story, but thanks to the work of some incredible writers, some modern writers, an author named Matthew Spector, who wrote a book, Always Crashing in the Same Car, and author Nick Pinkerton, who was actually here on this stage about a year ago because he wrote the film The Sweet East that came out last year. They have done some really, really good research on the history of Carol Eastman, and we have just enough facts to piece together her story. And I want to share a few of these facts with you because this woman, I believe, single-handedly changed the trajectory of American independent film. And we would not have Sundance films, we would not have an entire tradition of American character portraits without this script. So, Carol Eastman, she was born in 1934 in Glendale, California. Her parents were below-the-line workers. Her dad was a grip. Her mother was Bing Crosby's assistant. she grew up wanting to be a dancer. She actually was a backup dancer in the Audrey Hepburn film Funny Face, but she broke her foot in 1957, and she turned her attention to acting. And she joined this now kind of famous acting class taught by a blacklisted Hollywood actor named Jeff Corey, and maybe it was because he was a former communist, and maybe it was because he was blacklisted. He attracted this kind of like underground, late 50s, like cool guys circulating around Hollywood in that time. So she would take classes with guys like Warren Oates and Dean Stanton, who would later add a Harry to his name, and guys like Robert Town, the screenwriter who just passed away, rest in peace. But she gravitated the most to the one man in the class who was probably her polar opposite. This guy was extroverted, he was opinionated, and his true gift was that he almost compulsively couldn't not live in the moment. And this man, of course, was Jack Nicholson. And Jack Nicholson and Carol Eastman, they came together, and not in a romantic way, but they became lifelong friends. Well, Carol Eastman, she goes on, she actually books a small role in Alfred Hitchcock's Presents, an episode of Alfred Hitchcock Presents in 1962. But after that, she seems to get disillusioned with acting, and she turns her attention to writing. And what's interesting is that Jack Nicholson is almost doing the same thing at the same time. We think of Jack Nicholson as like the super, uber-duper star. I mean, he's incredible. He started his career as a writer. Yes, he was getting some B-movie roles in Roger Corman films, but that wasn't paying his bills. So Jack Nicholson, he's working for Corman. He and a buddy named Monty Hellman, they go to the Philippines and they do this classic Corman move, which is that they get the budget for a very low budget film in the Philippines. And it's like, well, we got the crew here, let's make 2 movies. And so they go over to the Philippines, they shoot these 2 movies, they come back. Roger Corman says, oh, that was pretty good. Why don't you guys do it again? Except this time I want you to make me 2 westerns in the wastelands of Utah. And Jack says, okay. So Jack is going to write one of those films. It ends up being called Ride in the Whirlwind. And for the other film, he contacts his old friend, Carol Eastman. He says, will you write me this script? And she agrees. And they get together. They start writing together. And it's actually quite funny to think about these 2 completely opposite personalities sitting in a room to write. And in one of her only published quotes, her 2 published quotes, she comments about this here. And I love this quote because it says so much about her and the way that she thinks. So this is discussing her and Jack Nicholson sitting in a room to write together. Quote, as one who reaches for her 6-shooter if she hears a pin drop on the next block, it wasn't the most auspicious of circumstances that we started, at Nicholson's suggestion, to work in the same room. I love that quote. Who talks like that, man? Like, there's like 5 sentences in that sentence. And it's witty, and it's dry, and it's biting, and it's funny. It's Carol Eastman. It's like all the things that are like amazing about her. Anyway, the film that she wrote is called The Shooting. It is awesome. It's got a total cult following now. But at the time, it couldn't even get distribution. What it did get her was her next job. Her next job was writing the debut feature for a little-known fashion photographer by the name of Jerry Schatzberg, who would go on to direct The Panic in Needle Park the following year. And he was making this movie for his then-girlfriend, an unknown woman named Faye Dunaway. This movie was called Puzzle of a Downfall Child. But while Carol's working on Puzzle of a Downfall Child, Jack Nicholson, he's kind of tapping into this thing that's going on, this, you know, movement that's sweeping across the West Coast in 1967 called The Summer of Love. And this ends up dictating his career. He writes a movie for Roger Corman called The Trip. It stars Peter Fonda and Dennis Hopper. He then goes on and makes the next film, Head, with Bob Rafelson, which is the Hard Day's Night like parody film starring the Monkees. And Bob Rafelson, for those of you who don't know, he is the guy that came up with the Monkees and directed the Monkees TV show. But Bob Rafelson wanted more from his life. He wanted more artistic integrity. So he goes, he founds a production company, and he's looking to define himself outside of television and outside of the Monkees. And so for their next film, he gets the crew back together. Peter Fonda, Dennis Hopper, Jack Nicholson, the very first film that he produces on his own, a little thing called Easy Rider. Now, this film obviously taps into a huge cultural moment. It goes on to become the fourth highest grossing film in 1969. And all these guys are poised. You know, they've all been working for 15 years. They're all in their mid-30s. They are poised on the precipice of achieving their dreams. You know, Bob Rafelson is really about to be taken seriously as he wants to be taken seriously as a director. Jack Nicholson, he gets an Oscar nomination for Best Supporting Actor in Easy Rider, but he wants to make that oh-so-difficult jump from supporting actor to leading man. So who does he turn to for this incredible once-in-a-lifetime opportunity? He turns to his old friend Carol Eastman, who had been tinkering around with this script for 5 easy pieces. And I think that this is amazing, because these guys were at a position in their career where they really could have done anything, and they chose to do this film. Well, this film comes out to wide critical acclaim, and that critical acclaim ultimately leads to box office receipts. It's briefly the number one film in the country, and the guys get what they want. Bob Rafelson becomes that defining director of a generation. Jack Nicholson rockets to superstardom. Everyone gets what they want except for Carol, because this film is, in many ways, the zenith of her career. After this film comes out, for which she is nominated for an Oscar for Best Original Screenplay, there's a few blurbs in the trades that she's maybe thinking about directing, maybe a film starring Jean Moreau. Matthew Spector, in his book, Always Crashing in the Same Car, he goes through her personal archive, which is now housed at the University of Texas in Austin, and he has actually uncovered letters between Eastman and Jean Moreau that suggest Eastman perhaps was in love with Moreau, and that these feelings were unrequited, and that's why the project failed. Jack Nicholson, loyal as always, he tries to get Eastman her next job. He teams up this super team in 1975 with Warren Beatty and director Mike Nichols to produce her next film. It's called The Fortune. It comes out. It's almost like a sure thing. I mean, it's Jack Nicholson and Warren Beatty and Mike Nichols. Come on. It bombs. It's a commercial failure. None of those guys take the blame. Carol Eastman does. And she would not get another script produced for 17 years. Finally, in 1992, once again, she teams up with Jack Nicholson and reunites with Bob Rafelson on a little film called Man Trouble. She has her other published quote about this film, and it's about her hiatus, and I find this very interesting. She says, quote, "I went through a self-imposed hiatus of 5 years, maybe longer. I don't keep track of time." Unfortunately, Man Trouble was also a failure at the box office, and it all but ended her writing career. Eastman died in 2004, a few weeks shy of her 70-year-old birthday. Jack Nicholson gave a eulogy at her funeral to the small group of people that she had let into her life, and there wasn't a dry eye in the house. I find it really hard to make sense of this. I think it's a little easy to lump Eastman into the trope of these sort of like haunted female geniuses, as if she was like the Virginia Woolf of Wilshire Boulevard. You know, I also don't think it's exactly fair to cast her as a victim of a sort of sexist, money-grubbing shit machine that Hollywood is. I think she might be something else. I think she might be something that we often don't like to think about our artists. It could be that Eastman is the type of person who valued the act of writing over the performance of success. And that is why the characters sing with such a beautiful wit and sadness and tension in this film, because that is really the theme that she is exploring. So I encourage you, as you watch the film tonight, experience this as the closest you will ever get to knowing this incredible artist in her own words. Like I said, I will be back after the show to open up an audience discussion, but for now, I'm gonna shut up so we can sit back and enjoy 1970s Five Easy Pieces. Thank you guys so much.
So it is at this point that we screened the film. And if you are fortunate enough to live near an independent rental store like we do here in Atlanta with our beloved Videodrome, I would highly recommend that you go on down and rent this film. If not, if you don't have that resource available, it is streaming on Amazon Prime. I think you can also rent it on a bunch of other streaming services for like $3.99 or whatever. If you really want to recreate our in-theater experience, our screening was actually interrupted at the six-minute mark by an electrical storm that caused the power to flicker and thus caused the digital projector to freeze and have to be shut down and restarted. The audience sat patiently for about 8 minutes as our beloved Plaza crew worked tirelessly to get everything up and running as quickly as possible. But after the screening, as everyone wiped away the tears from their eyes, I came back for our audience discussion. Please enjoy.
Give it up. Five easy pieces. All right. I know I'm jumping in here and everyone's sort of still sitting with it. If you have to take off, thank you so much for coming. If you can, stick around. What's up? Oh, okay. Well, I'll get right to it. If you can stick around, we're going to do a little audience discussion. But if you've been to our show before, the way I like to start this off just to get the juices flowing is I jump in with some bad letterboxed reviews. Okay, bad letterboxed reviews, half a star. Quote, did Jack have to do this movie in order to do another film he really wanted to do? Damn, Jack, I hope the paycheck was good enough. Okay, one star, miserable. I hated every minute of it. This movie goes against everything I live for. Okay, one star. About an hour in, I remembered some porn scene I probably torrented in college in which a woman walks across a tiled floor in ridiculous 6-inch heels and sits down at a grand piano in ridiculous lingerie and plays some, I don't know, Bach concerto she learned in a previous life, and then she has pornographic sex with a man. So that was much more affecting and thought-provoking film about a former piano player. One star for the hitchhiker ladies. I don't know. This was not my review. One star, five easy pieces of poop. Okay, so with that, I'd like to open it up to some instant reactions. Does anybody want to share some thoughts? Well, you jumped in here with a question here. Hold on. Here, I'm going to hand the mic over. Yeah.
You mentioned Carol Eastman. She was not mentioned as the writer.
Yes, so this is actually something I missed in my monologue. One key piece of information, which is that she wrote the first three of her films, all the films during the zenith of her career, under a pen name, Adrian Joyce, an androgynous pseudonym. It was only her last two films, 1992's Man Trouble, and then one other made-for-TV movie that she wrote that I can't remember the name of, that she was actually credited as Carol Eastman. But yes, Adrian Joyce is her pen name. Yes, yeah. Any other instant reactions? Did you like the movie? Yes, great. Here, I'm going to hand the mic over.
First of all, this has been awesome. I have to come to more and more of these. Just from an actor's point of view, one thing that really stood out to me was when he comes back to the house and he's, you know, looking at all these rooms that he knows, you know, he knows the layout of everything, and he opens the door to the piano room and he doesn't, like, peek around the door. He peeks through the slit in the open door because he just knows where everything is. So I don't know, maybe that was Jack's choice. maybe it was specifically written by Carol Eastman, or maybe it was a director's choice, but I just thought that was, you know, it's like these little details that make all the difference, you know? Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. I think this film is absolutely jam-packed with those types of details, and it really makes rewatching the film over and over again incredibly special. I kind of want to jump right in, and where I often like to start sort of like in opening up the discussion is really talking about the main character. We experience movies through the protagonist, and this protagonist is he's quite a doozy. So what do we think about old Bobby Eroica Dupuy? Do we like him? Do we hate him? Yeah.
Yeah, not to get here again, but, you know, this is my third time watching the movie. I have grown to like him more and more every time. I get what he's going through. I understand where he's trying to, like, figure out his life. I also recognize, like, this movie was made in 1970, so the way the women are portrayed is not the best. And they're always like, you know, hey, we support Bobby, we support Bobby. But it's one of the most nuanced Jack Nicholson roles I actually can think of in my life. Great performance. And that's all I say.
Yeah, excellent. I, too, am more empathetic with Bobby as I watch the film more, certainly more than the first time. I mean, it's like, it's so hard. He's a piece of shit, right? Matthew Spector, the author of Always Crashing in the Same Car, put it really well. Here, I have a little quote for us here. Well, actually, I don't have a quote. Basically, Matthew Spector put it in a really good way, which is the magic of this film is that it's about a complete asshole. And through the wit and tenderness of the words that they're saying, and also through Nicholson's performance, we are compelled by him. But I think it's really the story that is sunken beneath the story that's in the subtext that makes us feel for him and love him. And that's the story that is ultimately revealed. You brought up also the many women that, you know, surround him throughout this film. I'm curious if anybody has any thoughts that they'd like to share about whether it's Rayette or Catherine Van Oost. Eastman gives the characters the best names. Yeah.
Just as far as the relationship to women, it's the stark difference between almost every other woman and his sister. Like, you see him light up when he is with her the first time we see him, and when we see him come in while she's playing in that studio, and the love that he has for her, and like the that relationship is insanely palpable. I think it's because it's hard. I think it's hard to go, this guy's a complete asshole, because it's like, you know, 1970s, and he obviously, like, we're not talking, like, therapy is not a thing. Talking about one's feelings is not a thing. And so it's hard to kind of put that overall title on him. But the thing that made me love him was his relationship with his sister. So that's what I have to say about that.
Yeah, I love that. I love that. And, like, I, you know, we would maybe in, like, modern screenwriting parlance, like, it's his relationship with Tina is, like, when he saves the cat. You know what I mean? Or, like, when, you know, the save the cat is, like, the idea of, like, in modern screenwriting, you want your character to do something, even if they're a total asshole, you want them to do something lovable, like saving a cat from a tree, to make us get on their side. And modern screenwriting books will tell you to do this within the first five pages. But in this case, Tina is sort of built into, right, as we get towards the midpoint of the film. And I would totally agree. I would totally agree. I'm curious the point you brought up about the, you know, it being, yes, it is taking place in the 70s. And yet I also find the nature of Bobby and Rayette's relationship, while of course couched within period language, there's also something about it very universal. Does anybody have any thoughts about Bobby and Rayette and the way, you know, their unhealthy dynamic plays out that they'd like to share? Yeah.
Well, I honestly, definitely, in the period of the 70s, my initial impression was like, wow, this guy is such the classic internet boomer stereotype of wife bad, hate wife. Like, I thought that was such an intense crystallization of that, and how that was so highlighted for like the first kind of act of the movie, it made it almost hard to watch. That was like, that was the misery and suffering. Like, it was so sad. It was so sad to see that play out. But definitely, there were weird modern touches. I don't know why, but the stuffed animals on their bed, that's just something that like brought such a weird sense of modernity to it. Like, I don't know, that the sort of like appeasing Ray with gifting her the little stuffedies that they keep on the bed. That is such a like a modern trope, I feel like, but I guess not. I guess it's just something that's persisted through the decades. I definitely would say, though, I think he is, in my opinion, categorically an asshole. I thought that was a really good performance. Jack Nicholson really does nail those roles, doesn't he? For me, the saving the cat sort of thing for me came at the very end, when he was in the bathroom and just no dialogue. I had the thought like, oh no, he's gonna ditch her there. He's gonna leave her. But I thought he was gonna take his car. I thought it was it really showed that he left her the car. You know, she has a way. He left her a little bit of autonomy. She can drive the car. He's not completely stranding her. He hitchhiked with the truck, and that for me was the real like, wow. I guess he must have cared about her a little bit, that he did that for her. I don't know.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, great point. Sort of the ending. He leaves her the car and he leaves her the money, which, again, I don't think this like takes away all the bad things that he does to her. But what this, but like, it speaks to what the film is like getting to in the subtext, which is that this is a man who is incapable of love. And we are finding out subtextually why that is. We are going back in time. We're watching his childhood play out within the subtext of the film to see how he got to this place where he is so uncomfortable with himself, he is incapable of embracing other people. And that is a dramatic accomplishment for a narrative piece of fiction. I want to also talk about some of the other characters. Does anybody have any thought? Oh, first of all, trivia question. Hold on one second. I'll get to you. Trivia question. Does anybody know who the secret celebrity that is one of the hitchhikers is and what she is known for? Yes, sir.
Yes, it's Tony Basil is known for the song Mickey. Oh, Mickey, you're so fine, you're so fine, you blow my mind. Hey, Mickey.
That's right, yes. Yes, thank you, very good. Yes, that is Tony Basil, which is a wonderful little piece of movie trivia that she stars as one of the hitchhikers. Anybody else with thoughts about the hitchhikers and sort of like what they added to the story? I mean, I love them. Yeah.
Yeah, well, like from what I've seen this film about four times now. And just like I've always been like, to me, like an essential American film in that sense of like, especially of the time period being 1970, of that like counterculture, you know, hippies and like intellectualism coming in bloom. And he's kind of like the guy lost in ideas, almost like trying to find where he belongs in society. With his friends, his family, with people, just, you know. And as far as, like, the hitchhikers, that sense of, like, you know, is still very much, you know, reflective of today, you know. And then, like, people who kind of dismiss that also, like, you know, like, okay, just shut up about that stuff. But, like, you know, but it's important issues and stuff, you know, just, but, yeah, it's just a little...
Yeah, for sure. I think I love the hitchhikers so much because I'm definitely the guy who's like, it's all just shit. They're just making shit. I don't even want to talk about it. I love that. Okay, I started all this off in the monologue saying that this is the closest any of us would ever get to really knowing Carol Eastman. Did anybody feel like they learned anything or felt any sort of kinship? Yeah, back here.
Hey, I was thinking the ending, it just encapsulates everything. Like, he had two breakthroughs. He always felt above his girlfriend. Like, he was obviously like, I'm better than you. But when somebody else did it, somebody else was above her, he said, wait, no. You're not shit. Like, you don't talk to her like that. And then we felt like he had another breakthrough with his dad. He knew that he just ran away when things got bad. So, okay, maybe he's changing. But at the end, he still leaves her. So I feel like even if he had therapy, even if you have these quote-unquote answers to yourself, like, what does that mean? Does that mean that doesn't mean a happy ending? That doesn't mean, oh, I understand why I do the things that I do, that I'm going to become better, quote-unquote better, or what society thinks is better. I might still do it. I might still think I'm right. I might just understand. Like, what does it really mean to understand your actions?
So you think that that's sort of the ultimate message of the film is one of self-awareness, or sort of the strange relationship that we have with self-awareness? Is that where I just want to make sure I understand?
Yeah, I mean, I think she does want you to be self-aware, but even when you're self-aware, there's not this ultimate answer of being, oh, okay, now I get my life. Oh, now I know what to do. I don't think you ever know what to do.
Yes, totally. Which I would completely agree. I mean, I think he has some conscious level of knowing what's going on, and yet his actions are incapable of changing. That his brain is not enough to compel him into a happier, better life. And that's how he leaves him. He's still running. And some say he's still running to this day. Yeah, totally. Yeah, right here.
Can you ask me the question one more time, though?
Yeah, of course. It was about the relationship with the writer. This is probably the closest we'll ever get to her. What do you feel like you learned about this woman, Carol Eastman? Yeah.
No, I think it's we get this most feminist idea of what we can get at that time. And she's trying to look at the way men see women. And it's not the best way back then, 1970. It's not the best way. And she's trying to give it a really honest depiction, because when I first watched this movie, I've seen it, this is my probably fourth time, I hated the Karen Blackman character. Yeah. You know, the little ditzy, yeah. I didn't like her. I was like, she's so annoying, I hate her. But I get why she's so important, because she is what all the men think women are supposed to be back then. We think, oh, yeah, she's supposed to be just do what you want. And I love you. And I think it's more nuanced, especially since you told me that she wrote under a pen name. It's very hard to write back then in Hollywood, to write like a real movie that makes women like look great. And I wouldn't say honestly, like, I didn't like this movie because it made her look so bad, and I didn't like it. And but the second time I watched it, I was like, wow, she's really smart. She's really smart, and she knows what she wants, and she wants to get it, and she goes for it.
Yeah, absolutely. I would say that if anything, the depiction of this film, it's brutal. There's rough edges, but everyone is given three dimensions of their soul. There are no two-dimensional characters in this film. Even the nurse has like layers to him that we discover. Yes, sir. Here.
I just kept thinking of the concept of the human heart in conflict with itself, and that's what I kept thinking about him. Is that he was so torn, and he was torn apart inside, and he was torn apart outside. And also, I was just really impressed with Karen Black in terms of the pathos that she brought, because it could have been a total caricature. And she really did saw a lot of humanity and feeling, and I really liked her character. I could understand how people, you know, bashed her like they did and everything. And I mean, I thought he was really shitty to her, so ultimately.
Yeah, Karen Black, incredible performance, incredible artist, just all around, writer, musician. She's just amazing. Yes, sir. Here, we're going to wrap it up with this, a little final comment here.
No pressure. yeah, I mean, I don't know, you know, whether I think I have any, you know, familiarity with Carol Eastman as a result of this, but, you know, it does, I do feel a little sympathy for our letterboxed commentators in a certain sense, because it is really a relentlessly grim film, right? I mean, like, not only is this guy an asshole with no way out, but nobody else presents any more attractive option for how to live one's life. There's no character who counts as living, you know, a, let's say, reflective, autonomous, actualized life in the entire thing. I mean, possibly Catherine Van Oost, possibly, but she's even depicted at the end of as kind of giving up and accepting something that she herself recognizes as kind of a little dull. And everybody else is, you know, self-deluded or, you know, tyrannical or tyrannized or in some other way, you know, damaged. So it really is quite a, I mean, it's a beautiful film, but it is a grim film.
So you are co-signing 5 Easy Pieces of Poop is what I'm... That's what I got from that feedback. Just to distill it down, is that...
Good listening, Aaron.
Yes, okay, good. thank you. Well, I want to wrap it up with this. There's one final Carol Eastman quote that I've withheld from you this entire time. This may be the key to the entire mystery. Okay, so Matthew Spector, in his book, Always Crashing in the Same Car, he, like I said, he went through Carol Eastman's personal archive and scribbled at the top of one of her notepads was the following statement, quote, "I am Carol Eastman. I live at the Chateau Marmont Hotel. I have 3 cats, and I am a writer by choice." Ta-dum. Thank you so much for coming tonight. Have a great night. Get home safe. Come back. We'll be back in 2 months with a film that is yet to be determined. Thank you, guys. I'll be there. Instant service, speedy, fast. I was your first, I'll be your last. No matter who you have in between, when there's a fire.